change the order a little bit due to the schedule. So I'd like to move Professor Hawkinson to the next speaker.
I'm not sure if I should use the mic or not. You think I should use the mic?
Yeah.
Yes. Is it okay to start?
Yes, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Just a short self-introduction. My name is Eric Charles Hawkinson. Please call me Eric. I'm originally from America, Arizona. Been in Japan for about 13 years. I'm currently teaching at the School of Community Engagements at the University of Fukuchiyama, which is a rural area of northern part of Kyoto Prefecture. So I'd like to thank Andrew for switching with me because I need to get on a train to get, if I don't leave on that one, I can't get home, so thanks for switching with me for that.
Sure.
Information technology with tourism. For the last 10 years or so, that has been, I started doing some e-books with the e-learning stuff around 10 years ago, but I quickly started to port those learning contents that I was creating over to something called augmented reality. And for the past, since about 2011, I've been iterating on this technology for its use in automated tours, in navigation, and but augmented reality is part of a host, a part of a spectrum of technologies that starts to meld digital contents with reality. And it's actually on a spectrum of from the real world to what we experience in virtual settings. And one kind of good way to think about it is a new realm, a new evolution in mastering the way digital contents is brought to consumers. So we can have, so we can see sort of like this progression in distribution of information in print, recording, cinema, radio, television. And now we have the internet and all those technologies that preceded it, like magazines, books, and newspapers, in our pockets with mobile technology. And with augmented reality, what that does is take all that content back out of your pocket and connect it to physical objects in the real world, to emotions, to things that are happening around you, to people's faces, to perhaps a set of GPS coordinates, anything and everything that is physical around us in the real world. Now those digital contents are now connected to us in some fashion. What I just mentioned before, so this is not just, this is a, kind of like a spectrum of technologies. And these iterations that I'm talking about in the tourism field sort of try to play with different levels of digital versus real integration and what that means for a user's experience or the utility and affordance for tourism and tourists. So we're in the real world now, talking, well, you could argue against that some of us did, right? And on the other end of that, we have a completely simulated environment, usually inside a computer. Now we have these virtual constructs where you can actually jump inside a simulation where your movements are completely simulated and given to you that don't have any real connection to the real world other than the digital representation that has of the real world. What augmented reality is somewhere in between that. And so it starts taking digital contents and putting it in real world situations. So you can imagine looking at something with your phone and your phone giving you contents relative to your location on the planet. And that is one form of augmented reality, using your GPS coordinates to relay curated content to you via the radios in your area. You could also argue that we're kind of, my talk right now is a bit augmented because it's being supplemented with digital content behind the screen. So here's a quick example. This is where I live in Kyoto, Kawamachi. It's usually packed with people, but you can put up your phone. Your phone has various radios and sensors. It knows where you are because of a GPS locator. It has a motion sensor to know where and where you're looking. And then it figures out where exactly you are on the planet. And then it looks at the visual information coming in through the camera and starts to put it together with already uploaded pictures on the internet. And then it knows exactly what you're looking at. And so therefore, you can put digital information on top of it. So now you're looking down the street with your physical camera, and it puts in, for example, you may be looking for an ATM or something like that. So it puts that, this is it, this is what you're physically looking at, and that's what that information is. You can also connect that to perhaps your social feeds on your social networks, and then you get real-time content on physical objects that relate to you and your friends. So this has already been used in tourism for several years. This is one of the first case uses. You can see at least 10 years of being able to walk around the city, getting navigation. We're here to talk today about audio tours, and that, in a way, in a sense, is sort of an augmented reality type situation. 40, 50 years ago, this is one of the first examples of this, right? So if you're flying a plane, your real view is overlaid with airspeed and altitude and other information to tell the pilot where and how to go. So as we talk about some case uses today, I want to try to just lay down some basic terminology that I'll be using a lot. First one is trigger. So trigger is an event, a person, a place, a thing, a location, something around you that triggers some digital content to pop up, triggers an event in some pre-programmed function. Could be where you are physically on the planet. It could be recognizing an object nearby, or it could be another sensor that's related to another person that you come in contact with. So that trigger then, when that trigger is triggered, something is overlaid on top of reality. That could be an image, it could be some audio, anything digital content. You could be shown on websites, any digital or information from the web, audio, for example, from a previous presentation earlier today. So you have your trigger, and then that's the physical object that then gets overlaid with some digital content on top of it. And putting those both together, depending on what application, what software, what platform you're using, they like to call. This is, they're trying to market these terms in different ways, an aura, blip, an augmented project. But that's basically combining the trigger with an overlay. That's like an AR event. Right, so I have a bunch of case uses. I'm going to try to go through them as they evolved. When I first started using it, I had published an English language textbook about 10 years ago, and I went back and redesigned it with this technology in mind. So a smartphone application would be triggered by the illustrations and images within the book with audio and video content that supplemented the materials in the textbook. And after a year of playing with that, I quickly realized that the behaviors of students using it, although I liked it, they were going out to the web and viewing video and other supplementary materials on the web. The use of this technology became redundant because students learned where that stuff was, mostly on YouTube or Quizlet or some other functions like that on the web, and they were going directly to that material. So it helped change behaviors in a way, but the technology itself became unuseful after students learned what was happening. It was a bridge that was no longer useful. So I started iterating on this and started getting in the hands of students. Especially for things like open campus and campus tours. And this is an example that we had in 2012, where a group of students made a scavenger hunt. They created a narrative. One student was the chief of police, and another student was a thief who stole some important information from the media center, which is our library. And you came into the media center with a pre-programmed mobile device, iPads and Android tablets, and you were given a poster to look at, and then you got a video from the chief of police saying, "Please help us, we need your help, some information stolen," and you got a hint. And that hint brought you to some other location in the library, for which you got another hint. And this progressed for about 8 to 9 steps. And after the course of this sort of gamified scavenger hunt experience, you learned what facilities were in the library, how to look up a periodical and a book, and the procedures involved in checking out books and other materials from the library. So it's like a gamified tour, basically. And I think this is very relevant to a lot of things happening right now in augmented tours. Another example in the MICE realm of tourism, I'm involved with TEDx Kyoto, which is one of the largest TEDx events in Japan. Are you all familiar with TED?
Yeah.
Great, so I don't have to explain that too much. In 2014, I was leading a group called the Interactive Team, and our job was to create ways in which people can interact and find each other and sort of informal team build where they weren't watching the actual talks. So we created some applications and booths, and one of them was this AR experience that we created. And we knew that because this was new technology, we needed to sort of step up gradually into it. When we did this with students before, in the classroom setting, we were able to give some orientation, some instruction about how and when to use the technology. But in an event setting, people need to be able to do this on their own with little or extra instruction or help coaching. So we devised a system to where we had low, medium, and high-tech integration, the level of technology use. The first one was just with pen and paper right next to the augmented reality, one of the experiences. Next one was where you didn't have to install or configure anything on your mobile device. You could just show a paper to a PC with a webcam on it, and some information would pop out at you. And the high one was an app you developed. You downloaded it to your own personal mobile device, and you were able to both get supplemental information from the guidebook about the speakers and our partners, but also you could go around the venue to our partner booths and some of our other sponsorships and find out more information about the venue, what's going on through this augmented experience. So the paper or pen one is very simple. They wrote messages to themselves to the future, but the next one is on a booth. So each person had a program, and that we pre-programmed that art into a PC application, and when shown to the PC with a webcam, something was overlaid on top of it. So, let's see, here we have somebody showing their pamphlet to excuse me, a computer screen with a webcam. That now becomes I Love TEDx Kyoto with a bunch of hearts and things flying around it. And we would take screenshots over the course of the day and be doing a live Twitter feed to try to get conversations between the people who actually had the event and viewing the content online. So that was something that got people to understand what kind of this technology was. So you're showing, you're putting stuff on top of physical objects. So from there, you're offered to download an application for which we had these triggers all around the partner booths, for when which you pointed to your phone application at, supplementing materials about those partners, what projects they were doing, some about extra information about the speakers that were involved with the event would pop out of them. And we did something what's called a Twitter rally, sort of, it's kind of like a stamp rally. We talked about that earlier today as well, where each of these functions would automatically connect to your Twitter application and tweet out with a hashtag. And if you completed all 10, found all 10 of these, and went back to our booth where we had the first interaction, we were given a 10x t-shirt. So that kind of incentivized and gamified our participants to go and kind of interact with our sponsors. So we kind of did a rudimentary count in this. So we counted how many people wrote on a piece of paper, how many screenshots we took of people coming up and experiencing that, and then counted how many downloads of the application. And we can see that, of course, that people drop out at each stage. And there's other things involved here. There's time constraints, how much time do you have in a break between between talks, but as someone who studies technology, I couldn't help but notice that this curve beautifully conforms to the diffusion of innovation theory, which when we have our early adopter phase, people lining up for the first iPhone for the first day one, people that have smartphones, and then we have the people that still have got a key type phones or something like that. So it sort of lines up with that very beautifully. And this is a good thing to keep in mind if you're looking to adopt this technology to the settings, because one, it's still kind of new technology and it's not universally adopted yet. And you're going to have different types of interests in the technology that drop off with each level of technology that you're trying to. So the biggest one that culminated, this is the second year of an AR rally that we did in Fujiyama, where I live, where I work. It's an all-day community engagement event at our university where we have students, it's part of their orientation week, sort of a gamified experience, where the object is, because we have a community engagement course and we want students out doing volunteer work as much as possible. So it's supposed to connect students and city people that work in the city, doing a lot of volunteerism in the city, to the students. So we put them in teams, and we give them this app, and they go out and basically do this large gamified competition where they're going around the city, getting hearings, talking to people that run NGOs, people that work at the hospital, but also collecting information around the city in teams together, being guided by this application, augmented reality application. Last year we had 200 participants. We were broken into teams into 10, mostly new students and a couple of experienced students, and most of the teams had one faculty or staff in them. And we had 22 different locations, and this took a bit of logistics and calculation. We had to kind of figure out the walking distance between each one, because some locations couldn't take more than one or two teams at a time, or if one team was leading and they knew how to complete a certain challenge, we didn't want one teaching the other, didn't get an advantage of it. So we had to kind of figure out the lay of the land and try to time where students were going when. And we controlled that in very different ways. So this iteration of it is an application I developed to try to get this kind of design concept in the hands of students. And what I did is I designed a set of playing cards specifically for this purpose. And here's an example of it right here. This is the Ace of Clubs, right? And this is an image specifically designed for a computer vision algorithm to easily recognize it and be easily distinguish it from the rest of the cards. There's an individual illustration that's supposed to be doing on each card, and different design, different gradients to help a computer algorithm recognize the specific cards and differentiate from the 52 other cards. So we put poster versions of these up around the city. So when the smartphone application looked at these specific cards, video, web content, audio would pop out and guide them or give them challenges of what to do in that specific location. This is just a demo that I created to show you what that might look like. So there's the card looking at it with the naked eye, And here is what it looks like through the computer overlaying video content on top. You can see it's moving in real time and tracking, so if you're moving around, looking at content for reps on the wall, it gets bigger, smaller, and closer the further you get from it than if you're moving it around. And you can orient content to that in different ways. So you can see that this video is raised up quite a bit from that content, or you can put it behind you if you have the correct technology or devices around you too. So there's a whole bunch of tricks that you can play with this kind of technology too. So here's one example of this. This is, we had a castle in town. So one of the spots was a castle, and they had our city mascot up on the top floor of the castle, and basically all they had to do was go find it and take a group photo with it, and they could move on to it. Send it via text, and we're using something called Line to send messages back and forth to collect, to harvest video and content that the students were creating, but also to help kind of traffic groups so they would run into each other. So we had a couple orientation for this. Give students some Wi-Fi access to download it beforehand, and a long enough time so older students can kind of help instruct the newer students about what the technology is and how to use it. The entire freshman class for about an hour for this orientation. And on the day, we had to create something called mission control. So we were tracking the movements of all these teams and where they were going. So a couple of volunteer students would have a big whiteboard where messages would come in online. They'd write on the board where they were so we could track the movements and how they were progressing through the day. And there were four main augmented reality stations. There were about 12 to 20 hearings, public hearings, with different people in the community that they were meeting. And there were some secret missions throughout the day, which kind of like scout accounts, so we designed into them so we could have buffers of time. So let's say they completed something quick, they needed to move on, we could give something kind of quick and easy for them to do anywhere to complete during the time that they have extra. So one of them was at the castle, the Flood Museum, Citizen Plaza, which is like a library / public space, and a disaster prevention center where they were learning how to and what to do in case of a flood, which we have a lot in our city, or earthquake. This is an example of what would happen if you showed up at the Citizen Plaza, looking through the device. So we have the stand here with an oversized version of one of the cards I just showed you, and it'll just take a second to load the digital content. So now a video is being overlaid on that, and it's a video for me, telling you where you are, and telling you to take a specific route up to a specific room on the fourth floor. And as you go through this route, there is the history of the city written on the wall in various places on stairs. And what I've done, honestly, is show you the route right now as you walk through. So as you go through this route, I put even more cards on the wall. What I did that is all the content is written in Japanese. So what the augmented reality does is overlays English content on top of the physical written Japanese on the wall. So what you do is you go up, you look, scan this, and you can see this right now. So now the wall is now written in English, from which the information was originally in Japanese. So they're going to, as a team, they're going to walk through this route that they originally told to do all the way to the end, for which there is a lockbox with several locks on it and a cipher. And locks have, all the locks have 4-digit codes to open them, and they're given hints of what happened in the history of Fukuchiyama. And if you successfully enter the years for each of those locks, you can open the box and get the next card, which gives you content to go on to the next challenge. So this is sort of like a team challenge, and they're learning how and when the city formed and the municipality formed. And the first year when this ended, we, at the end, we had an award ceremony, we had a point system. We evolved that in the second year to have sort of a group discussion session where all groups would get together and make newspaper articles for what they accomplished and learned of the day and share them with all the students in general. And this is, I think, a more beautiful portion of this because this technology, I think, works best when mixing in a lot of human elements. Especially in rural cities where this was, in tourism, a lot of the affordance that the rural area has is being able to get away from technology and connect on a human level. And so I worry and I'm concerned a lot about how this technology will either erode or change it in a way to have it lose some of its deep human connections that we have. So what I'd like to do at the end of this is kind of have humans together with this experience that they've had together, try to have some human connection built on top of it with the experience. One good slash important meaningful thing, or it could be a bad thing depending on how you think about it, is this technology collects enormous amounts of data. Because of all the sensors that I mentioned before, your GPS locator, your sensor, your camera, for research purposes, this is great because you know where people are moving, how they're using the information, and the timeline for which they progress through it. As a researcher, this is concerning, both because you start to learn to your ethics behind the collection of data, and participants knowing just how much data that is being collected about them. And I'm already in school districts, not so much in tourism yet, but these augmented reality tools are being banned because they're considered unsafe for use, especially with small children. Now, I don't know if you've been to a hotel where they give you a free mobile device. This is happening more often these days. But there's some hotels, you check in your hotel room, there's a free, it's almost like it looks like a phone. And that's mouse, you can take it out of the room, and you can take it around the city, it has a guide to the city. That device is probably tracking you. That device is most likely tracking you. Because it's given to you free, the business models involved in augmented reality and the products that are involved with them sell your foot traffic, sell your online behavior to leverage to create profit. So just that understanding alone might give a researcher pause in implementing this technology. Just an example, this is a plot graph of the rally that I just explained. It's every time a car was triggered, it would put a blip on a map. So I can tell that some students were way off course, but somehow they were still getting... This also has a little bit of error on it too, but I suspect some students were taking screenshots of cars. This is kind of hacking in a way, and sending it to other teams where they can then pull out the data from a screenshot of the actual physical car. Right? So, like any technological thing, these things can be hacked in some portion of the program. This is a timeline, so we can see what cars and what locations were being engaged with and how and the frequency at which they were being engaged with. And that particular exercise, the particular activity was covered by Arcadia's Kill the TV and was on a couple of news articles. It was very successful. Now, let's talk about how this is going to be integrated in especially tourism settings. So we start to need to think about the technology and how it's getting things out of it versus the preparation and cost and the acceptance from your target audience might have this sort of technology. There's a bunch of different theories and ideas and concepts that you can use to help you decide and design these kinds of environments. But they all revolve around these ideas, right? So what are the needs of the participants or the consumers or the tourists in this setting? The design of the products and the software with it, the user interface and user experience that is required sometimes is needed differently for different cultures or ideas or languages. And that's one other good thing about this where they've been before usually, so you can customize content for each user for their specific languages depending on what their settings are on their devices. So stakeholder value, so for example with Rally, you're working with NGOs and the city and other volunteer organizations, and they wanted to get students involved in their activities. We wanted, as a university, to get our students off on the right foot by building strong relationships, productive relationships with each other and faculty. And we wanted them to learn the basic and most important information they might need to start a new life in the city. And the research approaches that apply to this, I'll explain that just in briefly. So we've been using something called design-based research or scenario-based research when we use in tourism settings. It's because we are creating something new, it's difficult to set the guidelines and data examples and outcomes or set specific hypotheses for which to prove or disprove because this type of situation, this environment has never been created before. So this kind of thinking, this design approach, is a very iterative approach. So you are concentrated on the self-building type of research model, and I think it works well with this type of environment. The scenario-based stuff helps in tourism settings a lot of times because it helps give specific stakeholders their own role and their own what they might get out of, what they might need to put into this type of activity or environment. So you're giving them a scenario like, this is the activity that we'll do, this is what we see students happening. Kind of put yourself in that situation and see what that scenario gives to you or your interests. Another big interest, fascinating thing with this is, I talked about this technology being a bridge before, right? And sometimes a bridge can be so high up and so big and so fantastic that you're so involved with the bridge itself that you're not really so concerned anymore, at least temporarily, about where you're going. Because of the great view, because of your high level, because you're experiencing something new. And this technology sometimes makes you experience things so different that the content you're trying to deliver is detracted from because of the way it's being delivered. So we're just seeing a video here of somebody just experiencing some VR content, and he just can't, his senses are overwhelmed. And at the end, he doesn't even know what the maybe he knew that it was a roller coaster, but where it was and what it was supposed, what information it was supposed to give to him was detracted from it. And that's what happens a lot. There's a lot of wow factor, there's a lot of novelty that happens, especially the first time use of this. Students and users are, for the first time, are very curious about how it works and why it works, rather than just the content you're trying to deliver with that information. Right. So where are we going with this? So Pokemon Go, we've learned a lot of lessons because this is a very well-known and widespread case of this technology. People hunting for digital creatures that are not really there in real life, but they're there in digital form. And in a good sense, we've got people out off the couch and out into the world, but they're out in the world with half of their mind looking for something that isn't really there. So we have issues like people trespassing, or not looking at the road, or just basically not paying attention to the world around them at the level that they would be if they weren't using this technology. This is one danger that this technology can have. It can give us a lot as far as supplemental information, gamifying and more enjoyable custom content, which we want to know and experience for our language, for our culture, for our interests. But it divides our attention more and more, the more rich, the more immersive that information gets. This technology is now starting, if you've ever heard of the hype cycle of technology. So usually when it first comes out, we first hear about it, we think, oh, this technology is going to save the world, it's great. And then we start to realize that there's some things that we can't do or it doesn't meet your expectations, so there's called a trough of disappointment. And then it starts to build out of that and it starts to see more widespread use and be put into more and more contexts. Starts to become more ubiquitous. And you could argue where we are with this technology in that scale, but for the most part, we're either going into or already in the disillusionment, the disappointment phase of this technology. A lot of people think it's going to revolutionize the way tours and experience travel, but at the same time, it's very dependent on data. This is very bandwidth heavy technology. A lot of video, a lot of audio, a lot of things that, so we've already talked about the Wi-Fi issues, especially in rural areas in Japan. The technology issues of the mobile phone. If you need to augment visual data, the graphical processing power needed for that is still quite high. So if you don't have one of the latest phones, this could be slow or not just not a great experience for you. So you could be disappointed. That happened with Pokemon Go too. The business models around this are, I talked a little bit about that already. Pokemon Go makes money on both ends. They sell you virtual items in the game to help catch Pokemon, but they're selling more foot traffic, and they're selling the ability to pull you to locations. For example, all McDonald's in Japan are either Pokemon stops or Pokemon gyms, where people are more likely to go and sit down and have a Coke or a burger while they catch Pokemon. So those are bot locations instead of. So we're going to move on to this, where the latest iPhone, they all have two cameras in them. If you're humans, we want depth perception, we need two eyes. So all your phones from here on out will probably have at least two cameras in them, probably more. Maybe they need other sensors like infrared or depth sensing information, and this is specifically for this technology. So they can measure depth, and when something goes behind something else, we can recognize that object is closer than it was before. That's one of the reasons Pokemon was so disappointing to a lot of people, because you thought Pokemon was going to run up on a table and touch you, but really it was just overlaid on top of the screen in front of you. It wasn't really realistic. But we're getting to the point where we're going to start putting our phones on our faces. And a lot of these things are already out, and for tourism purposes, and for the wide, bigger idea of how we communicate and navigate our daily lives, this has larger, every social impact that our mobile devices have had on us, with Facebook and all this stuff, is, in my opinion, going to get exacerbated with these new technologies. We're already starting to get phone numbers because of our phones. Just think, if you look at someone, and the name is over their face, or we can remember people's names, or how to get home, or all that kind of stuff. There's a lot of other concerns about that too. I have all this information, videos, and things like that on the web. Please don't hesitate to either contact me or reach out if you have any more information about this. So, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Do you have any questions?
Too many.
Is this the first time that you're hearing a lot about this?
No, I've heard about it. You know, I'm an old-time programmer, so
okay.
I programmed and designed systems for 30 years and then retired a few years back. But, you know, just the fact that it's gotten this far, mm-hmm. you know, is amazing to me. I realized that it must be moving on along on other levels with something like Pokemon Go comes out and you got that. I want to know, when's your next rally and can I come? Seriously. I'm in Iwakuni. I'll jump on a shin and I'll go up there.
Well, unfortunately, I was planning to do another one this year, Kuchiyama, in April, but I accepted a tenured position at another university.
Won't be there.
So I'm now planning to design a new rally in Kyoto City, which will probably be more accessible to you and other people. But when that comes out, I'm not quite sure. for sure. Probably won't be next April, but I'm planning on doing something this year.
How do people get the expertise to develop something like that for Yamaguchi? Because in a way, the whole point of this gig, as I understood it, was how do we draw tourists to Yamaguchi Prefecture? And this seems like an excellent way to, maybe not a rally, but maybe if you develop the awareness that they can have that kind of experience, mm-hmm. people might say, hey, you know, let's fly into one of the regional airports and take off from there on a tour.
There's a couple of comments I could say about that. One is, up until recently, you needed some coding knowledge, some almost a lot of the software that's made to build environments like this look a lot like a very complicated like Photoshop environment. Mm-hmm. There's a large learning curve involved with that.
Yeah.
And that's one aspect of the design of this that I've created, is that the triggers are decided.
Right.
So you have a set of images that are freely available to students for which they can use for these environments. Because you need to have some understanding of computer vision algorithm to be able to either take pictures or know what objects. It works terrible with text, so if you think you're going to get a computer to...
Well, it allows you to constrain the triggers and design the interactions based off of that.
Exactly.
So in that case, it's just to change the code.
So I've been using this to put into the hands of students, and the current iteration of this application I've developed is basically a Google form, which has an image for each of these cards, mm-hmm. and you just go and put links to YouTube videos, to web content, to audio content, and you get your project name. You load up the app, and then you go find that project name, load it up, and then all the digital content is now associated with those cards.
And will we come to that off of Tidehawk on Facebook or off of GEric.com?
But there are also several commercial products that are easy enough now for students and like tourism promoters to use.
Right.
There is a danger with that, like I said, with the issue of privacy and data collection. So a lot of those companies that are allowing you to use their stuff for cheap or free are either pushing advertising content or collecting data in a very aggressive way.
One specific question, and then I'll get off of this if anyone else has questions. I noticed that you're using GPS to keep track of these kids, but yet when you were doing your team planning, you were...
using Line?
Using a
whiteboard, yeah.
Right, and I was just curious.
GPS mapping allows you to track like a
fire department would use, or a...
Yeah, that's just the limitations of the software that we're using. So, mm-hmm. AR software is every time an image is recognized, every time something is triggered, it saves that GPS location and adds it to the map, which I showed you.
Mm-hmm.
But we had a bunch of other challenges, like, for example, go take a picture with the mascot, or go find someone and ask a question, which is face-to-face in real-life type situation. So we added a line group for the whole event, so when students needed a question or they got lost, also had to do with that. So I was having students write the messages of where they were on board to help augment the data that we were getting from the augmented reality app.
Yeah, okay.
And also gave the students that mission control. So
what can I do besides just sit there and watch a screen? Yeah.
Okay,
cool. Thank you.
Discussion will be continued, but each time for your training.
That's it.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.